Good morning. Let's start our lecture. First of all, I recall the main topic of the previous lecture. The last theme, which was considered in the last lecture, was inevitability of the linear operator. I recall that if we have arbitrary mapping F which acts from some arbitrary set X into other set Y, and F is injective, if for any different X and Y, which belong capital X, we have that its images F at X and F at Y are different. And F is surjective if for any Y from capital Y exists X from capital X such that F at X is equal Y. If F is surjective and injective, or and injective, F is called bijective, and a very simple exercise. F is inevitable if exist J, G, the mapping from Y into X, such that composition F, J and F is identical mapping of Y, and position F and J is identical mapping of X. We have the following picture. And composition F and J is identical mapping of X and composition identical Y and composition F and J is identical X. J X identical Y. Identical X. Proposition uh, easy, enough easy exercise. F invertible if and only if F bijective. If F bijective, we then enough easier construct inverse mapping for F, and by opposite way, if F is invertible, easy to see that F bijective because let easy to see that if F invertible from left side, we can see that this assertion is equivalent for that this mapping is injective. And let's suppose that F invertible, and then exist G such that composition F G is identical mapping of phi. From this fact, easy to see, it follows that F is injective. Let x1, x2, let x1, x2 is different element of X such that its images are coincide. Easy to see that in this case the composition JF X1 composition JF X2 are the coincide, also coincide, because by definition inverse mappings, this one F and this one is composition J from F X1, J and F X2. If this element are coincide, from this it follows that the images of this element must also coincide. But from other hand, this composition is identical mapping, and this composition is identical mapping, and we obtain that this element is equal x1 and this element is equal x2, and we obtain that these elements are different. From this it follows that we suppose that f is not injective, and we obtain that f is not invertible from the left side, and it proved that f is injective. The same way here, to see that if gf is invertible from the right side, we obtain that f is surjective. And in the case of the linear mapping, we proved in the last lecture that injectivity of the linear mappings is equivalent to the fact that kernel of f is equal zero, and we can apply our basic definition to the case when f is a linear mapping. Let f is a linear mapping. Proposition. Let's note that the we have the following fact: f is injective if and only if kernel f is equal zero. Second item: f is surjective if and only if image f is equal w. We suppose that f is a linear map from V to W. Let's prove the following, the first item of our assertion. Excuse me. Maybe you have a question. I recall that the main facts from the previous lecture. First of all, I recall the definition of the invertible mapping, and I note that criterion of invertibility for arbitrary mapping. But we have suppose that f is an arbitrary mapping from set X to set Y, and the criterion invertibility f invertible if and only if f bijective, and this criterion has two items: f invertible from the left side if and only if f injective if and only if exists such mapping G from Y to X such that composition f and j is identical identical mapping of X. And the same way f be surjective if and only if composition GF is surjective if and only if such composition GF is identical Y and F injective. The corollary of this fact is the main theorem F. Surjective. Suppose. I'm sorry. Yes, if invertible from the left side, if and only if F injective. And yes, yes, from the left side. Excuse me, from the left side F injective. Yes. And from the right side, yes, F surjective. And the corollary of this fact is the F invertible for both sides, if and only if F bijective. And we apply this general assertion to the partial case when the mapping F is a linear mapping. And we have the following corollary. F is injective if and only if kernel F is equal 0. And the second fact, F is surjective if and only if image F is all spaces W. The second fact is trivial. The definition of surjective, but the first item of this corollary is very simple, because if F is injective, this assertion, let F is injective. Then kernel F is equal 0 is obvious assertion, because if kernel F contains two different elements, it means that the images of these elements are coincide, are equal 0, and such mapping is not injective, because we have two different elements which our mappings maps to the one element 0. And obvious assertion. But from other hand, if we suppose that kernel F is equal 0, and F is not exact, if F is not injective, then exists such element x1, x2, different element, such that its images are coincide. And from this fact, it follows that if difference f is a linear mapping. And from this fact, it follows that the difference is equal 0, but F is linear mapping. and this by definition of linearity, this difference is equal image of the difference x1 minus x2, and we obtain that this element is equal zero. It follows that the difference x1 minus x2 belongs to kernel F. But this element is not zero because x1 is not equal to x2. And from this we obtain that kernel F is not zero. And we suppose that our mapping is not injective, and we obtain that the kernel of this mapping is not zero. And that we prove that kernel F is equal to zero, then F is injective. And then we prove that injectivity of F is equivalent to the fact that kernel F is equal to zero, the criterion from this fact. And from this proposition, it follows the main theorem, which was proved on the last lecture, and very short proof, and I think it will be useful to repeat the proof of this main assertion. We have two theorem, one and two. The first theorem, the theorem about arbitrary linear mapping, which acts from arbitrary vector space V to the vector space W. And by definition, F mapping F is invertible if and only if this mapping injective and surjective. By definition of by theorem for the arbitrary X is a partial case from general assertion. And then using this proposition, we obtain that F invertible if F has the zero kernel and the image of the F is all space double. If we apply the theorem which related the dimension of the image and the kernel to this fact, we obtain the following interesting corollary. F is invertible if and only if kernel F is equal zero, image F is equal W. If you apply to this fact the theorem which related the dimension of kernel and image, I recall that the sum dimension kernel F, dimension image is equal dimension V. This theorem was proved on the previous lecture. If you apply this assertion to the other proposition about invertibility, if you suppose that F is invertible mapping, this kernel is equal zero and dimension is equal zero. And from this fact, we obtain that dimension image F is equal dimension V, but im F is equal W. And we obtain that if F is invertible, from this fact, it follows that dimension V is equal dimension W. Dimension V is equal dimension W. And if we have such mapping, first of all, we suppose that V and W finite dimensional vector space, because this theorem can be applied to the only to the case when both vector space V and W are finite dimensional, only in this case. And in this case, we obtain the dimensions of V and W must be equal if we want that the mapping F be invertible. And naturally, to consider that the case when our linear mapping is endomorphism. If we know that for invertibility of linear mapping, necessarily that the dimension of the spaces V and W must be equal, we can identify these two mapping. In this case, we obtain that our linear mapping is endomorphic. And let's formulate the criterion for invertibility for the case when the F is endomorphic. Suppose F be endomorphism of the vector space V. And the following assertion are equivalent. F is invertible, first assertion. I reformulate this theorem. Theorem 2. The following items are equivalent. first f is invertible. F is injective. F is bijective. Oh, is surjective. Kernel F is equal 0. Image F is equal V. Let F is endomorphic. Using of finite dimensional vector space V. Clicks. Matrix matrix of F matrix F year of F is invertible. Determinant of matrix of the operator F here is not equal 0. The following seven assertions are equivalent. First of them, F is invertible. Our proposition asserts that F injective if and only if kernel F is equal 0. F is surjective if and only if image F is equal V. Easy to see that these two assertions are equivalent because this theorem about dimensions of linear mapping F asserts that dimension kernel F plus dimension image F is equal dimension V. Easy to see that if kernel F is equal 0, let kernel F is equal 0. Then dimension kernel F is also equal 0. From this theorem, it follows that dimension of image F is equal dimension V. But image F, if F is in the endomorphism, contains in V. If you have some subspace which has the dimension which is equal of dimension V, dim F. From these two facts, it follows that dim F is equal to V. If you have subspace which has the same dimension as the dimension of all space, this subspace is coincide with all vector space. because you can choose the basis in F, and this basis will be also the basis of V. And we proved that if kernel F is equal zero, then image F coincides with V. From this fact, it follows if you suppose that kernel F is equal zero, then image F is equal V. And we proved that if our mapping is injective, then this mapping is surjective. Opposite way. If you suppose that image F coincides with V, we obtain the dimension of image F is equal dimension V. From this fact, it follows that dimension kernel F is equal zero. If dimension of subspace is equal zero, it means that this subspace is equal zero. And we obtain that this mapping is injective. Suppose image F is equal V. Suppose that our mapping is surjective. Then dim image F is equal dim V. From this fact, using this assertion, we obtain that dim dimension kernel F is equal zero. From this fact, it follows here F is equal zero. And we obtain F is injective. And we obtain that if image F is equal V, from this fact it follows that kernel F is equal zero. And we obtain that these two items are equivalent. And from this fact it follows that if injective, if and only if F surjective. And easier to see that this equivalence of these two items means that in both cases F is bijective, and the fact of F bijective equivalent the fact that F is invertible. And we obtain that all these items, one, two, first, second, third, and fourth, are equivalent. And fifth, I'm sorry, fourth and fifth are equivalent. And last two items. Easy to see that if F is invertible, the matrix of F is also invertible. By definition, F invertible even or only if exists G such that the composition identical mappings of V. If you consider the matrix of this mapping, we obtain but the matrix of the identical mappings is a identical matrix E. The matrix which has on main diagonal units and other elements I equal zero. By definition of the matrix of composition is equal the product of the matrix of corresponding operators. And we obtain that the product of the matrix F, E and G, E, the matrix of the linear transformation of some basis E. So this product is equal identical matrix, and this product is equal to the product of the identical matrix. It means by definition that the matrix F is invertible. And in the last semester we proved that invertibility of the matrix is equivalent to the fact that the determinant of this matrix is not equal zero. And we obtained that last item also equivalent all previous items of our main theory. And we obtained this such extended criterion for invertibility of the linear transformation. And the theorem we will use later, maybe this lecture, maybe on the next lectures. Basic fact for invertibility of linear transformation or linear endomorphism. Next story, which we are going to consider, the partial case of linear transformation. The partial case of linear transformation, linear functions or linear functionals. Dual space. Questions. To understand it. This is the basic theorem which we will use later. And other story. Dual spaces. What does mean dual space? let V be a vector space. Our sum field K. For us, K is a real number field or a complex number field. The main example, K is a real number. And V be an arbitrary vector space. We can consider the linear mapping from V to the basic field K. We can consider the basic field K as one-dimensional vector space over itself. The basic field by definition, is one-dimensional vector space over itself. We can consider the basis in this do you understand that basic field is a vector space over itself? Do you understand that this fact? What does mean that some set is vector space? Vector space is an arbitrary set which has two operations, addition and scalar multiplication. Basic field K contains the operation of addition, addition of the numbers. And field has the operation of multiplication. And we can consider the element of basic field as element of vector space. This natural defined addition of the numbers and scalar multiplication, which in this case coincides with multiplication and field. And in this case, the unit in the field can be considered as a basic element. Moreover, any non-zero element can be considered as an element of the basis. And we obtain the infinitely many bases in this vector space. It's a very simple fact. And from this point of view, we obtain the partial case of the linear mapping from vector space V to the one-dimensional vector space, which coincides with basic field K. But linear maps. And such linear maps is called linear functionals or linear function. By definition, what does mean linear function? If you apply f to the sum of arbitrary vectors u and v, we obtain the sum of the images for any u v from capital V. And if we multiply arbitrary vector v on arbitrary scalar lambda and apply the our linear function f to this product, we obtain the product lambda onto image of v under action of f. These two items is a definition of the linear transformation from V to the K. And as was mentioned above, the set of all linear transformations from one vector space U to V to other vector space W forms the vector space. In our case, we also can consider the set of all linear transformation from V to K, all linear transformation. And this set is form the vector space which denoted by V star, and this vector space is called dual vector space. definition. All linear functionals from V to the case to the K forms the so-called dual vector space. I call it if you have two linear functionals f1 and f2, you can consider its sum is defined as functions which at on the arbitrary vector V by the rule we must apply F1 to V, apply F2 to V, and to add to these two vectors. And by definition, it means that this vector, by definition, is the sum of linear functionals F1 and F2 which we apply to the vector V. You get to see that this function is a linear function. We proved this fact above. And the same way, the product linear function F onto scalar lambda is a function which acts on the arbitrary vector V by the following rule. We multiply lambda on the image of vector V on the action of F. We proved above that vector space VW, vector space of all linear transformation from V to W, has the dimension which is equal product of dimension V on dimension W. Well, because whom the vector space of all linear transformations from V to W naturally isomorphic to the space of the matrix of the size n m our field K. If dimension of V is equal M, dimension W is equal M, this vector space of all linear transformations from V to W are isomorphic to the vector space of all matrices of size N times M. Because we have one-to-one correspondence between the operators and its matrices. If we have linear transformation, we can consider its matrix, consider the matrix of its linear transformation. And the correspondence linear transformation matrix of linear transformation is bijective between linear transformation and operators. And this correspondence induced the isomorphism between vector space of linear transformation and vector space of the matrices. And two vector spaces are isomorphic. And from this fact, it follows the dimensions of this vector space is equal. But dimension of the vector space of the matrices of the size Nm is equal product of the dimension vector space V and dimension of vector space W. And we obtain this following fact. From this fact, it follows that dimension of the dual vector space coincide with dimension of initial vector space V. We obtain dimension V star is equal dimension V. We give two independent proof of this fact. First, first proof was given above, and this fact is it follows from more general fact about a dimension of the vector space of linear transformation. Do you understand this proof? Dimension of the vector space of all linear transformation is equal product dimensions of V and dimension K. But dimension K, our K is equal 1 by definition. And we obtain the product of dimension V on unit is equal dimension V. It's a very simple fact. The first proof. The second proof. The second proof is follows. Let's consider the following functionals. Following linear function. I'm sorry. First of all, let choose a basis E of vector space V. We fix some basis and consider the following system of linear functions on V. I recall, if we want to define some linear mappings, we can define this linear mapping only on the vector of the basis. It is sufficient to define the linear mapping. The linear mappings uniquely defines the values on the vector on the vectors of the basis, and we can define the following linear functionals, linear functions, e up I on the vectors of the basis the following way. If indexes functionals and vectors coincide, the value is equal 1. If the indexes are different, the value is equal 0. We obtain the system of linear functionals E1, E2, EN. I assert that arbitrary linear functionals can be present as a linear combination of these linear functionals, and these linear functionals also linear independent. Easy to see that enough to prove that these linear functionals are linear independent, because if we have a system which contains the n linear functionals, the n linear vectors, the n linear independent vectors in the n-dimensional vector space, these n linear independent vectors form the basis, in our vector space. And let's prove linear independence of these functionals. We can consider the linear combination of these linear functionals. And suppose that this linear combination is equal to 0. And apply this linear combination to the vectors, basic vectors E, J. With 0 linear functionals, and we also apply these functionals, functional to the basic vector EJ. We obtain that the right hand on this equality is equal to 0, because we apply 0 functional to the vector. The result of such application is 0. By definition, 0 functional, if you apply 0 functional to any vectors, we obtain 0. By definition, 0 functional. And left hand, we obtain the following by definition of the vectors E up I, all summons will be equal 0. Only one summons E up I after application to the basic vectors EI gives us the value which is equal to 1 by definition of the element of this basis. And in this case, we obtain lambda I times 1 is equal to 0. From this fact, it follows that lambda I is equal to 0. This, we obtain that if we apply left hand of this equality to any vector of the basis, we obtain that any coefficients lambda I is equal to 0. It means that all coefficients is equal to 0. It means that this linear combination is trivial. It means that these vectors are linear independent. And we obtain that the element is defined by the following equality is linear independent and form the basis in the dual vector space. The dual vector space. Consider some examples. First of all, we can consider the matrix of the linear functions. We can consider the linear functions, the element of the dual vector space, as a linear transformation from V to the basic field K. Was mentioned above, and if we choose the basis, in the initial vector space V, we also choose as the basic vector in the vector field K, the element 1. And we must correspond to the linear mapping, linear transformation from V to K, the matrix of this linear transformation, the matrix which defines the basis E and this natural basis FE. By definition, we apply our functional to the basic vectors and we obtain the sum number. This number we can consider as a coordinate of this number in the vector field K. And we obtain the matrix row, and this matrix row the element of this matrix row is the images of the functional F, which we apply to the basic vectors of the basis E. And this matrix row is a matrix of linear transformation F. F1, F. Yeah. We also can consider the functional F as a linear combination of the vectors of the dual basis. We can consider the following decomposition. F-E-E-I. Easy to see if we apply this functional to the vector, basic vector EJ by definition, we obtain and easy to see that this coefficient, these numbers, coincide with coefficients of decomposition of the functional f on the in terms of the basis EI. This basis is called dual basis, and we obtain the element of the matrix row of the linear transformation, which we understand as a linear transformation from V to K, coincide with coefficients of the decomposition of the functional linear function F in terms of the vector of the dual basis EI. And then same element. If we have vector space V, and E be the basis in the vector space, and let E star be the dual basis in the dual vector space V star. We correspond to the functional F matrix row and the element of this matrix F1Fn coincides with coefficients of the decomposition of functional F in terms of the dual basis E star. And let X be the arbitrary vector, and we can consider X in terms on the initial basis E. Easy to see that if we apply our functional F to this vector X, we obtain the following equality. Obtain the full equality. On other hand, the action of the if you consider the matrix we can consider this number, this element, as as a vector of the vector space which coincides with basic field, and we can consider this number as a result as a result of decomposition of this vector, which belongs one dimensional vector space, in terms of the basis of this vector space. And I can consider this number as a result of multiplication matrix row F here, and matrix column X here. And in this case, we obtain the product of the matrix row and the matrix column. And we obtain that this number coincides with this one. So we can correspond to the functional F the vector row, and this vector row can be considered by the following two ways. From the one hand, this matrix row is a matrix of linear transformation from V to the one-dimensional vector space, which coincides with basic field K. And to the other hand, these numbers is the coordinates of the functional F in the dual basis E star. And these two different point of view are coincide with the same coefficients. And maybe two remarks. First, we obtain the dimensions of the vector space V and dual vector space are coincide. And from this point of view, we have isomorphism between V and V star. But this isomorphism is not natural. This isomorphism is following. If we choose the same basis E1, EN, we can consider the following correspondence. We can correspond to the vector of the corresponds to the vectors of the sum basis of V, the vectors of the dual basis E star. And this correspondence defines the isomorphism between V and V star. But this isomorphism depends from the basis E. This isomorphism depends from the choosing of the basis. If we change the basis, we change the isomorphism. but this isomorphism is not natural. But if the initial vector space have some complementary structures, for example, the initial vector space has a so-called inner product. In this case, we can construct the natural isomorphism between V and V star. But this isomorphism exists only in the some partial cases. For example, in the case when the initial vector space has an inner product. But we can consider so-called second dual, the dual space to the dual space. Namely, we can consider functionals which defined on the dual space. And this second dual space, it turns out naturally isomorphic initial vector space V. And we began discuss this interesting fact. I have time to consider in detail, but I began to consider this correspondence. Namely, let the element of the vector dual vector space let correspond vector V the functional FV which defined on the dual vector space V star. This functional acts on the element of V star by the following rule. Let L some element of the dual vector space A, and let by definition the action of the functional FV on the element of the dual space is the result application functional L to the vector. And I obtain a correspondence between element V to the element second dual vector space. And on the next lecture, we obtain that this correspondence is defined the isomorphism between element of the initial vector space V and the element of the second dual vector space V star. In this isomorphism is a natural isomorphism. In this enough important fact, which we will use in some application. I have any time to continue. Thank you for attention. Maybe a question about result. Have you a question now? Thank you for attention.